So read.
Hey, thank you. Hello. I'm Marco Sabatella. I have a small startup in Vienna called Danube Tech. I will talk a little bit about the Freedom Box, which is a project not so different from Cozy Cloud, I say. I have a prototype here, so it's also a personal server. The idea of hosting your data, hosting your applications at home, to be independent from the large monopolies. We all know the story, I don't have to repeat the rationale for this. I think the idea of decentralization, self-hosting. Freedom Box is a pretty old project. It has been around for several years, and it's an open source project. There's not really a strong commercial model behind it. It's more like a more loose open source idealist, activist, hacker project. The guy who founded it, a professor at Columbia University in the US, already said many years ago that Facebook has collected more information about individuals than all the totalitarian regimes of the 20th century managed to do. So there's been a lot of history and politics, political idealism behind it. But the basic idea, you have a box at home, a server at home, and you have your data in your own house, basically. The idea is to replace basically some of the applications that we use today with open source alternatives. So one difference to Cozy Cloud is that the applications that run on the Freedom Box are not specifically made for the Freedom Box. So these are all open source projects that different communities are working on, and they are alternatives to some of the centralized services we are using. So instead of using Facebook, you can use Diaspora as a decentralized social networking platform. And instead of using Dropbox, you can use OwnCloud or C-File. Instead of using Gmail, you can use a mail application like MailPile. So that's the idea, to basically package some open source software that has been around for a long time, but it's too difficult to use for people. Package it in a small box that you can just plug in and run at home. One disadvantage of this approach, probably as opposed to Cozy Cloud, which Benjamin explained, is that these applications are mostly disconnected, right? So you run these applications separately on your server, and you can use them, but they don't really talk much to each other. So you don't have this sort of unified user experience that Benjamin was talking about, where you have one unified data layer and all the applications use it and all everything. Works together. But the advantage, on the other hand, is that these applications are supported by broad communities, and they're not specific to Freedom Box. So Freedom Box just tries to make them easier to use. So you can just plug them in. And like I said, these are meant to replace individual services. But I would also like to talk a bit about the more universal idea. Is it possible to have a generic data store, a generic personal cloud where you can, have your my data, have your self-sovereign identity? That's a term that people like. Can you use it to aggregate and manage all your data, all the aspects of your digital identity? I really like these diagrams. If you don't know if you've seen that, the world that we have today. On the left, you go to Amazon. Amazon has a huge CRM, customer relationship management database, with all the users, and we interact with Amazon. We type our username and password, and we have a profile there. And the idea, which Doc Searls has been evangelizing for a very long time, is to turn this around so you have a You're the big dot, and companies request connection to you, to your data. And as Benjamin also said in the previous talk, it's really hard to do interoperability, to come up with one system that can do this for every use case and every actor in the ecosystem. There are some technologies like RDF, JSON-LD, Solid, XDI, which I've been involved with a little bit. OAuth, OpenID, UMA, that somehow try to build this generic identity layer, right? the digital identity layer that the internet has been missing. That's how Kim Cameron of Microsoft always puts it. Can there be one solution that binds everything together? And right now there is nothing like that. But let me do a demo of what something like this can look like on the Freedom Box. I have prepared one example website. This is a fictional supermarket website. This is a typical e-commerce website that I, as an internet user, may interact with sometimes. And so I buy a few things. I buy a piece of meat, and I buy some cheese, right? Put this in my shopping cart, and then I check out. So then I want to order these things. And today the experience looks like this. You have username and password. You have to fill in a profile, create an account on that specific website, just like you do on hundreds of other websites. And the alternative would be for that website to make a request to my data store and request the data they need, right? The data then being on my Freedom Box. This demo is done with a technology called XDI, which is not really widely used right now, to be diplomatic, but it does illustrate, it is capable of illustrating some of these ideas. So I will click on this button, and this will enable a request and a transaction through which the website will request the data from my Freedom Box. And in this XDI technology, we have identifiers, names, which we call cloud names. The idea being that we have email addresses, we have Skype addresses, we have domain names for our digital presence. But in this case, there's also an identifier for my data, for my digital identity, which in my case is equals Marcus. And I press continue, and I don't know if you saw that, but you will see that in a moment. So, and now what happens is I get redirected to my personal cloud. So I'm getting redirected to the Freedom Box, and if you watch it closely, did you see that? Did something happen?
Is it supposed to be?
Yeah. So there's a.
Ah yes, now.
Right. So there's a light.
Yeah, we saw it.
You saw it. There's a light that indicates whenever somebody accesses my data. So that's an interesting trick. It's a kind of a political idea, right? Today we don't know what happens with our data. We don't know who accesses it. In this case, you get a visual feedback whenever somebody accesses your data. So now I logging into authenticating to my Freedom Box. It blinks again. It blinks a few times. It's just the connection is not so great. And this is an authorization screen. This is where I see what is going to happen. So it says the shop, the supermarket, is sending me a connection request for my name and address. I see a little illustration here. It means some data will go from my cloud to the shop cloud, business cloud. And I approve this. And then in XDI, in this technology, in these terms, a so-called link contract is created. So there's a relationship now. There's a relationship between me and the supermarket, which means that they can access the data as long as that connection is in place until I delete it. Just have to wait. Okay, and I end up back at the supermarket website. This is a flow very much like an OAuth or OpenID Connect flow, using a few redirects.
Is it similar or is it actually OAuth?
It's similar. It's not OAuth. It's XDI, which is similar. And this is this is the screen that Le Shop would now see. This is an internal. This is the data that they have now, which they got from my Freedom Box. And I'll show you something else. I'll show you. Show you a mobile app quickly. But so I will now show you an application that is running on my phone. It's a little smaller, maybe not. There's an application which I call Cloud Navigator, which also connects to my data on the Freedom Box. So it blinks again because now it's the application that the mobile app that's accessing the data on the box. This is pretty technical, so this is not as user friendly as Cozy Cloud certainly. This is more like a technical demo, but you can also see my mobile app is also connected to Equals Marques, to my personal cloud, and I can, and the box keeps blinking. And so here are my attributes, here's my data, and I can change it. I can, for example, maybe I want to move to Helsinki, and I save the data. The data is written to my personal cloud on the Freedom Box. Somebody's commenting on my command line activities. And now, of course, when the supermarket needs my information again, when they need my data again, then they will have to updated information without me actually having to interact with the supermarket, because there's an ongoing relationship. This is not just me submitting the information once, but it's an ongoing connection between the supermarket and the data on my box using a standard protocol. And I don't want to make this too long. There are several things that could be shown. I can delete the connection, then the supermarket would no longer be able to see my information. And this, of course, also works between individuals. So I can connect to my friends, and when the address, for example, changes, some data changes, and I get a notification that my data's my friend's data has changed. But I don't want to make this too long. I think the point is clear.
Part of the idea is that store is subscribing to you. They're subscribing to your address or whatever data you're going to provision to them.
Yeah. So the store is requesting data that they want, and I approve it or I reject it. And if I approve it, then they have the ongoing ability to read the data. So it's an ongoing connection. And same thing would also work with between individuals. So I can make a request from Equals Marques to Equals Bob, for example, to someone else who also has their own Freedom Box or has their data somewhere in a cloud. And then I can, and I should be able to access their data. So it's connections between businesses and individuals, and also between individuals. Yes, here I'm accessing Bob's data because I already have a link contract. I already have a connection with Bob, which he can delete it at any time. So that's basically it. I just have a few more thoughts about this whole interoperability discussion. Can all the different systems work together? Can I take my data from my FreedomBox, put it in my Cozy Cloud? Can I take my data from Cozy Cloud, put it into Miko, and so on? I mean, like Benjamin has already said, it's really difficult as the one approach to just define one standard that everybody will use. That's completely unrealistic, as some people have painfully experienced. I think it's very difficult to say here's the one thing that everybody has to use to be interoperable. I don't think it will work. The much more realistic approach is probably to just do small tests or quick hacks, or maybe not hacks, but mappings, translations, APIs. A few years ago we did that with OStatus when we tried to make different social networks interact with each other. So that can be done. Maybe there's a way in between. I don't know. Maybe at some point there will be something like a few conventions or maybe a standards-based approach that is really, really easy for people to use. Maybe something will emerge. I don't think it's clear right now. And that's it. Thank you.